So now the question is, fine, I went from cardinality of log h to log to the log of cardinality of h. Maybe I can do further small, maybe like I just give you two algorithm, right? Then if then we may ask the question, is it possible like I will get something better? Maybe something better could be just like I can say, okay, instead of log to h, is it like half of log to h? If I can get that, that algorithm is still better, right? That is giving, that is making smaller mistake. Now the natural question, when we have this, okay, this algorithm better, this algorithm seems to be still better, still this algorithm to be still better. So how much better we can do? Is there a limit to that? So that limit will be decided by what? Yeah, of course, but who is you are the one who is picking. There is an environment and you are a learner, right? You are learning an environment. If the environment become more and more and more and tougher, right? So as I said earlier, if I have not put this realizability condition, there is no way you could have gotten all these things, right? You environment could have made you incur loss in every round. So of course, what kind of bounds we are going to get, it depends on how tough our environment is. We had restricted our environment's capability by putting this realizability condition here, okay? Okay, fine. Even once we have put this realizability condition and we have restricted the power of environment, we may want to say, okay, under this scenario, what is the best I can do? What is the best bound I can achieve? Is it that log 2 cardinality h is the best I can do? Or something I can go beyond this, okay? So to do this, let's introduce some notion, and notice that this bounds I'm giving you is irrespective of how the environment is choosing xt's, okay? Even though I have said that there is a fixed h star that is going to assign label, I have not made any assumption that how this h star itself is chosen. The h star choosing could be very complicated, and because of that it may not easy for you to figure out what is that h star, okay? So to understand that what is the best we can do, maybe if we can give a lower bound on this, if we can say that, okay, no matter what algorithm you are going to use, you will be is going to incur at least this much of loss. That means that is like a dead end for me, right? Like no matter how intelligent I am, how best my algorithm is, I will be going to suffer this much of loss. Then we will see that if at all we can derive that, then we will see that whether whatever the upper bound I got was that how good it was compared to the lower bound. Okay, so to do this, we will just formally introduce the notion of mistake bounds and online learnability. Okay, let's say this is one sequence from the environment you faced, okay? In round A, in the first round, environment generated this pair x1 and the associated label h star x1 like that, and in the nth round this was the one. So notice that this is not the same sequence you are going to face every time you run an algorithm. If you are going to restart your algorithm, the sequence seen by you or algorithm could be altogether different, okay? So I am just saying, let's say this is one sequence that your algorithm faced, And let me denote MA of S, denote the maximum number of mistakes, sorry, the number of mistakes your algorithm made on this sequence S. So, for all my talk, all our discussion, we are going to fix this small n. We are going to assume that my algorithm is for run for some fixed number of rounds, that is going to be n. What my interest is, the number of mistakes I am going to make. And now, I do not want to, I will be not interested in giving a bound on a particular sequence. I would like to give a bound which is irrespective of what sequence I am going to see, right? Because I do not know what is the sequence my algorithm is going to face, okay? So, then I am going to denote so this is the mistake made by my algorithm A on a sequence S. Now I am saying that I am putting it against all possible sequences and see what is the maximum number of mistakes it is going to make on any of these sequences. So in a way I am going to take the worst case scenario here, right? I am looking at what is the toughest sequence you face so far. The toughest sequence is the one on which you made the largest number of mistakes. So that I am going to denote by MA of H. So H is my hypothesis class, A is my algorithm. So this is the maximum number of mistakes made by my algorithm A while learning my hypothesis class H. So then we are going to say that okay, now we are going to say that, and I think this is okay. Let me rewind this. I said that take an S which has this n points in this, and I am going to call this MA of S to be the number of mistakes made on sequence S, and now I am going to take this supremum or S to be the maximum number of mistakes I made in any sequence. And here I do not need to restrict my S to be of size n. This could be of arbitrary length. You may have run it for n equals to 100, or maybe you may have run it for n equals to 1000, or maybe n equals to 1 million. Now we are going to say that this hypothesis class is online learnable if there exists some algorithm A, I do not know what algorithm is this, for which I should be able to bound this guy. What is this guy? This is the maximum number of mistakes I am going to make on any sequence. If I can bound it by some B, which is a constant and finite, if that is the case, then I am going to say online learnable. Okay. Now, my two algorithms, like consistence algorithm and my halving algorithm, were they online, using them, if I have a finite hypothesis class H, can that finite hypothesis class be made online learnable using these algorithms? Okay, so like put alternatively, if I have a hypothesis class which is finite in size, is it online learnable according to this definition? Yeah, let's assume this right now we are in that realizability assumption. Is this online learnable according to this definition? So what was B for my consistence algorithm? Right. If H is finite, then cardinality of H is finite, and I can take that value as to be my B, right? So I have a bound which is independent of what was my sequence length. And for the halving algorithm, I got log 2 cardinality of V, which I can take it to be B. So that is why it is the case. So as long as I have a hypothesis class which is finite in size, I am good. According to this definition, I am learnable. It is not like if I continue to use that algorithm forever, I will make a large number of errors. At some point, you stop making errors because your number of mistakes is bounded by a finite number. After that, you are going to make no more mistake. Or just think of like if I have an algorithm, you start applying on it and you keep on applying it forever. After some point, that algorithm will not make mistake. Right, because you have ensured that its mistake bound is finite. Okay, fine. So now we have to now answer the question, what is the best we can do, right? Is this whatever B we got earlier, like cardinality H and log of cardinality H, is that something better than we can do better? Or if that's the case, what is that we should aim for? So for that, we now look a lower bound on the minimum number of mistakes that the environment can force on me. Because see, like environment is the one against whom we are learning, right? If the environment becomes complicated, maybe it can force more errors on me. But what is the maximum number of errors it can force on me? And can I also ensure that whatever it can force maximum number of errors, I will not make more errors than that. What are being enforced on me, which is unavoidable, okay, fine, that much errors I will make, but no more than that. Okay. So then we will talk about what we call as So any questions so far about these algorithms and the notion of whether a hypothesis class is online learnable? Okay, and so see how we are stating this research under what assumption? Like, if we don't have this realizability assumption, these are all incorrect. We will in the next class we will relax that assumption. Like, if we don't have that realizability assumption, what is that we should look for? Okay, so to understand this, what is the lower bound we are going to get on this mistake, we have to understand what is the power the environment has. So the power environment has, we should think it in an adversarial manner. So what is the best mistakes that the environment can force on you, right? So I mean, sometimes we see it in some sports, right, tennis and all. If you are playing against a very tough player, he can force a lot of error on you, right? Like, I mean, you can make self errors, but the opponent is very strong, you can hit it in some spots which will make you error. So it depends on what is the power of your enemy. Now here, let's treat the environment to be in a similar fashion. Let's say environment's aim is to just make sure that you make lot of errors. He want to win against you. how much errors you can force on it. Okay. So in that way, we are always going to treat this interaction between environment and the learner as a game. One guy is, you are trying to play, trying to learn your opponent, and by making minimum number of mistakes, and maybe like opponent, let's say he is trying to enforce a more number of mistakes on you. Okay. Now the question is, you have ensured that through these bounds, however tough is your enemy or however tough your opponent, I will not going to make more than these mistakes. You have ensured this, but now let's ask from the opponent's point of view or from your enemy point of view, how much mistakes he can at least enforce on you. That will be his question, right? So for that, we are now going to understand what is the power of environment or what is the power of your opponent. And remember, we are going to look at the power of your opponent or environment still under the restriction that he has to follow the realizability assumption. We have set up a rule for this game, which is realizability assumption. He has also has to show his power under this rule. So to understand this, we'll consider little bit of this tree structure. So consider a binary tree of depth n. Okay. So if I have a binary tree of depth n, how many nodes it is going to have? 2 to the power n plus 1 minus 1, right? So let's consider, for simplicity, let's take the case of simply 3 nodes. At depth 2, I have a depth 2 tree here and I have 7 nodes here. Okay. Let's call this to be V1, V2, V3. Now let's say I will come up with, I am going to look at for this points, I mean this V1, V2, V3. They are basically sample points, which we denoted as xt earlier. Okay, these are the ones. So V1 is the first point, V2 is the second point, V3 is the third point, like that. So let's say the adversary tries to follow, apply the following strategy. He will initially throw you V1. Let's forget what the learner is doing. Let's only think of from the adversary point of view or the environment point of view. He will start with V1. This is the root node here. And then let's say he is going to assign some label to this. If he applies label Y0 label, he is going to move towards its right child, and in the next round he is going to use this as his sample. If he gives label 1, he will move to this point and then he is going to use this as the next sample, like this. He keep on doing this. At this point, after he, suppose in this point if he has assigned label 1 to this, let's say he moved here, and at this point he assigns label 0, he will move towards his left side, and if we when I see this, let's say this is my right and this is my left. So when he is here, when he applies 0 label, he is going to move towards right, and then he is going to take left, he is going to assign label 1, and like that he keeps branching like this. Okay. So now if you have we have 2 to the power n plus 1 minus n nodes. I am going to enumerate them as v1, v2, v3 all the way up to v to the power 2 n plus 1 minus 1. So, these are the node choice he has, and using these node choice he has constructed a binary tree like this. Okay. So, now as I said, his strategy is going to be, he is going to choose x1 to be v1 to begin with. Okay, now right away let us at round t, let us do at round t, let us say at round t is at it is this current node. Okay, at something like, let us say it is this current node. Now, from this node, if he is going to assign a label 0, he is going to go to the next child node, which is towards his right, and if he is going to assign value label 1 to the point at it, he is going to move towards his left. Okay. So, let us say how to write. So, let us say if you choose xt equals to vt, I think I have to use this slightly different label to be consistent. Okay, I'll just flip the labels here. We go to left child if this is a goto, and then we go to right child if yt equals to 1. So, let us try to define just this strategy of, I mean, whatever this construct like this, and then we will see that how the adversary is going to use this to inflict, what kind of damage he can inflict on the learner. Okay, if this is the case, at ith round he is going to either right or left depending on whether your label is going to be yt equals to 0 or yt1, and I have labeled my nodes in this fashion, v1, v2, v3. If I have further down, I will label it as v4, v5, v6, v7, then v8, v9 like this. Okay. Then it is this case, what is it plus 1 is going to be? It is going to be 2it. So, I am going to one stage down, going to next stage. So, 2 into it plus yt. Can I write this in an iteration fashion? The node numberings. So, let us take the simple case. Let us say I am in this node, this is my IT. Let us say I made a label 1 and I came here. What is this value is going to be? So, it is going to be 6, right? So, 3, it is 3 to the 6.
Label 0. 2 times 3 plus 0 is 3.
Right. So, when I said it is going to come, this is going to be 0, right? Yt is 0 in this case, it is going to be 3 into 2, 6 we are going to get. So, like that I can iteratively like this, write this. So, this is it plus written expressed in terms of it. I can do the same thing, right? I can replace it here by it minus 1. If I keep on doing this repetition, what I am going to get? You can verify this. So, he can write it plus 1 in terms of the labels. So, finally, what I have it plus 1 expressed in terms of the labels I have seen till time t minus 1, right. Now, I am saying that let us say my environment is just going to use this strategy. He is going to start with this node, he will assign a label to that based on whether he assigned 0 or 1, he will go to the next one and he can continue to do this. Now, this is j running from 1 to t minus 1. Right. We are calculating the node at time t plus 1 that is expressed in terms of all the labels I have observed till t minus 1. Oh, okay. So, you are saying where t is missing, right? Let me check that. Just to be concrete, let us verify this one more time. Yeah, let's do this. So, let us say from let's take this path. Can you verify this quickly? So, we are getting this to be 5. If I take this path where 0 and this is 1. This looks correct, right? Okay, just let me introduce one definition and then we will break. So, how many of you have done again machine learning course in this? Raise properly hand. So, how many of you are already know the notion of VC dimension? You know VC dimension, which course? Okay, anybody else? So, in machine learning, especially in the supervised learning setting, those of you know what is VC dimension, I mean those who do not know about VC dimension, kind of VC dimension tells you what is the complexity of your hypothesis class, how tough it is, and based on that we determine what is how many samples we need to get so that we can guarantee certain number of error on your risk basically. We are going to use a similar notion of something VC dimension, we will come to that, but as always, like before we define the notion of VC dimension, there is something called shattering, right. So, we will just introduce the analog notion of that and we will just discuss that in the next class. So, those who do not know that notion of VC dimension, so just read it before you come to the next class. In the supervised learning setup, when you look into, basically if you look into the learning theory of supervised setting, you will definitely come across this this term shattering and VC dimension. So, as I said, we constructed basically this decision, binary decision tree, using these instances, right. So, let us say you have this sequence of instances which forms a decision tree of depth D. We are going to say that this decision tree here, whatever we have, is going to be shattered if there exists a hypothesis class H such that you give any kind of sequence of labels. So, you have these points, you give any arbitrary labels, set of labels of D up to D, then we should be able to find a hypothesis class H such that all these points here will be getting a label YT according to this strategy that we adopted. That is, the ITth node will be selected in this fashion, and when we select that ITth node, the corresponding node on that will get the label that you want. So, basically we are saying that this decision tree like this is going to be shattered if I can come up with the hypothesis such that you, for any given, you give me this sequence of labels, label series, right. So, these labels you are going to see, I will reproduce that label by taking this path. You understand this? Okay, so we will discuss this more, this notion of shattering. It will be easier for you to digest this concept if you look into what is VC dimension in supervised learning. Okay, we will revisit in the next class. Please do read that notion of VC dimension.